fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. The chief passport officer throws his hat in the ring. Kingsley Smith submits an application for the PLP nomination for West Grand Bahama and Bimini. A doctor charged with performing abortion. A man, another man, out on bail. Shot dead. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strachan, and this is Morning Blend.
Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way. You know that this is the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Tuesday, October 17th, 2023. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strachan. In a moment, Laverne Gardner will be joining us on this Tuesday morning. And also coming up, we're getting a preview of the AIDS Foundation Red Ribbon Ball for 2023. I'll tell you what you need to know and about the special theme this year. And later in business, the world just observing World Standards Day a few days ago, and we're going to be talking with the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality about their work here in the country. That's all straight ahead. But first, it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while we're sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, Chief Passport Officer Kingsley Smith formally applying for the PLP's nomination in the approaching West Grand Bahama and Bimini by-election, telling the Nassau Guardian that he does not feel threatened by fellow aspirant Shane Gibson, as he's known as a known commodity in the constituency where he was raised after being born in Freeport. Smith, who had sought the nomination ahead of the 2021 general election but lost to Obie Wilshkin, said he's confident in who he is. He's Smith, a former FNM, joined the PLP in 2020. In his charge of the 120th session of the Anglican Synod at Christ Church Cathedral in Nassau, Anglican Bishop Leish Boyd last night highlighting the high cost of living confronting Bahamians, he's appealing for value-added tax to be removed from bread basket items. In early 2022, the Davis administration fulfilled a key campaign promise when it lowered VAT from 12% to 10%. However, it also placed VAT on previously zero-rated breadbasket items, which was not a campaign promise. Boyd saying last night the cost of living has increased tremendously all over the world since COVID-19 hit. He said, quote, "Our islands feel this sting acutely. I wish to thank the government for all of its efforts to help the people of both countries, the Bahamas and Turks and Caicos. Measures to make the life of the poor and the middle class particularly more bearable. However, I wish to repeat something that I have said before, that is, the value-added tax is an unfair tax because it places upon all who seek goods and services a burden which the less well-off harder to bear, find harder to bear. Everyone is buying the same loaf of bread, but it's tougher for some to do so." A Supreme Court judge granting emergency bail to Dr. Jameel Minnis, the gynecologist accused of performing an abortion on a 15-year-old girl last month. Minnis, the 43-year-old son of former Prime Minister Dr. Ibrahim Minnis, is charged along with the minor's 48-year-old mother and 25-year-old sister. The women faced charges of conspiracy to commit abortion, and Menace faced a single count of abortion when they appeared before Senior Magistrate Shaka Serville. The teen's relatives are accused of conspiring to commit the abortion between September 3rd and 4th. Menace is alleged to have performed the abortion at his clinic in Harbor Island on September 4th. Damon Gomez KC, who represents Menace along with Cassie Bethel, called for a speedy trial, as he said the allegations would affect his client's professional reputation. He also requested the teen's medical records in relation to the fetus. They're not required to enter pleas to the charges as they will face trial in the Supreme Court. As such, Serville remanded them to the Bahamas Department of Corrections because he lacked jurisdiction to consider bail for the charges. However, Serville directed police to take the accused to the Central Police Station after being informed that they had applied for emergency bail. The trio appeared before Justice Wilhelmina Archer Mins at 2:30 p.m. for the bail hearing, which was closed to the public. The bail application was deemed an emergency because the prosecution didn't object to their release. The accused were each granted $15,000 bail with sign-in conditions. Meanwhile, the 25-year-old who allegedly got the teen pregnant, Alonzo Pinder, was formally charged with unlawful sexual intercourse on September 11th. Prosecutors allege that he had relations with the teen between June 1st and July 31st. Justice Jeanine Weech Gomez granted Pinder $9,500 bail on September 26th. And Acting Parliamentary Commissioner Arthur Taylor says that an ongoing police investigation into irregularities of the voter registration system in Grand Bahama will not affect the upcoming West Grand Bahama and Bimini by-election. Taylor telling the NASA Guardian that the police investigation began at the end of July and was triggered by concerns from Grand Bahama officials about the system. A 32-year-old man on bail for murder and dangerous drugs possession was shot and killed on Market Street. This happened yesterday afternoon. Police reported that they were alerted by shot spotter technology of gunshots being discharged on Market Street around 1:45 p.m. When responding officers arrived, they found the unresponsive man lying on the sidewalk. And the government of the Bahamas says that the last Bahamian national who reached out for consular assistance has been evacuated from Tel Aviv via Athens as the Israel-Hamas war continues. The government is saying that it's appreciative to the government of Canada for its support in providing space for its repatriation flight. It advised against all travel to Israel and the occupied Palestinian territories. More from that conflict overseas. Israel today bombing areas of southern Gaza where it had told Palestinians to flee ahead of an expected invasion, killing dozens of people. Meanwhile, mediators struggling to break a deadlock over delivering aid to millions of increasingly desperate civilians in the territory, which has been besieged and under assault by Israel since a brutal attack by Hamas militants. Flaring violence along Israel's border with Lebanon also leading to concerns over a widening regional conflict that diplomats are working to prevent. In Gaza, people wounded in the airstrikes were rushed to the hospital after heavy attacks outside the southern Gaza cities of Rafah and Khan Yunis. One senior Hamas official and former health minister reported 27 people were killed in Rafah and 30 in Khan Yunis. An Associated Press reporter saw about 50 bodies brought to a hospital in the area. Family members came to claim the bodies wrapped in white bedsheets, some soaked in blood. The Israeli military says it was targeting Hamas hideouts, infrastructure, and command centers. Israel has sealed off and bombed Hamas-ruled Gaza since the militant attack on southern Israel, October 7th, killed over 1,400 people, mostly civilians, and left about 200 captive in Gaza. In sports, the Bombers and Senior Men's National Soccer Team have a key rematch against Antigua and Barbuda in the CONCACAF Nations League tomorrow in Antigua and Barbuda. The League B Group D match gets underway at the Antigua and Barbuda Football Association Center at 3 p.m. And it's a key matchup for Team Bahamas. That game is actually today. They're looking to get out of fourth place in the group, and Antigua and Barbuda turned them back 4-1 at Thomas Robinson National Stadium on Saturday. Head coach for the Bahamas, Nestle Jean, saying that they have to put Saturday's game behind them and make adjustments. Read more about what he's saying in today's Guardian Sports section. Local bodybuilders, fitness, and wellness athletes will get another opportunity to advance themselves with the NPC Worldwide Caribbean Grand Prix Bahamas Pro Qualifier. That's set to take place here next month. The National Physique Committee event, which will be staged by Serge Sarek Productions, set for November 11th at the Atlantis Resort in Paradise Island. The check-in and pre-judging for athletes is set for November 10th from 5 to 7 p.m. More details about it in today's Guardian Sports section. From NFL Monday Night Football action, the Dallas Cowboys, an exciting game, rallying in the fourth quarter for a 20-17 win over the Los Angeles Chargers. And from Major League Baseball, the National League Championship Series, the Philadelphia Phillies getting past the Arizona Diamondbacks 5-3 to take Game 1 of the NLCS. Over in the ALCS, the American League Championship Series, the Texas Rangers getting a 5-4 win. They now have a 2-0 lead over the Houston Astros. And more from baseball. Kim Ang is leaving the Miami Marlins after 3 seasons as general manager. Marlins chairman and principal owner Bruce Sherman confirming this Monday. The 54-year-old Ang becoming the Major League Baseball's highest-ranking woman in operations and the first female general manager in the 4 major North American professional sports leagues in a groundbreaking hire back in November 2020. The Marlins exercised their team option for her to return for the 2024 season, but Ang declined her mutual option. Miami reached the playoffs for the first time since 2003 and swept the Chicago Cubs in their wild card series. Atlanta then swept the Marlins in the National League Division Series, but Miami showed flashes of promise and brought in Yang at the end of the season a couple of years ago to help surge the club forward. Yang won 3 World Series rings while spending 21 years in the front office at the Chicago White Sox, New York Yankees, and Los Angeles Dodgers before joining the Marlins. She was an MLB senior vice president for 9 years. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. Your first look at weather brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. We've got a stationary front that's sitting across in southeast Bahamas now and producing showers and thunderstorms along and ahead of the front of the boundary. High pressure will continue to build behind the front with cool and stable conditions across the northwest and central Bahamas. Beachgoers are being advised to avoid the water, though, due to rough surf and the risk of rip currents along north coast beaches. And mariners should be alert for water spout activity near the frontal boundary. Your forecast for today for the northwest and central Bahamas: variably cloudy and cool with a slight chance of isolated showers through tonight. Small craft caution in effect due to swells. Winds northwest to north, then shifting north to northeast at 10 to 15 knots. Seas 2 to 4 feet. Seas higher offshore in all areas and light to moderate swells. For the southeast Bahamas, variably cloudy and cool with scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms through tonight. Small craft caution in effect due to swells. Winds northeasterly at 10 to 15 knots behind the front and southwest to at 10 knots or less ahead of the front, falling to light and variable at times. Seas 3 feet or less, slightly higher in swells. Temperature-wise today, definitely you're going to feel the difference. Highs getting up to only around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting almost to the 60s, 70. Your expected low tonight, 70 Fahrenheit, 21 Celsius. How much longer can we expect the pleasant conditions? We'll tell you in your extended outlook and a look at the tropics coming up after traffic in just a bit. Your first look at weather brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. Elevate your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold.
Wake up, it's a new day.
It's time for break, but when we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Their home for fresh news and smart talk all day.
Wake up.
We are different. We don't just use beef. It's fresh, never frozen. Our burgers are square because we never cut corners. Served hot off the grill with fresh lettuce, tomatoes, onions, and American cheese. We believe in fast food done right. Always serving fresh, never frozen beef. Order a hot, juicy Dave single, double, or triple. Made with fresh, never frozen beef. Now only at Wendy's. Different inside and out.
Wherever you're headed, the Custom Computers Know-How team is standing by to help guide you in the East and the West. We now have two convenient locations on Patton Street in Palmdale and our newest store in the Caves Village Shopping Plaza through the Blake Road entrance. Discover the latest products by top international brands and the knowledge you need to unleash tomorrow's technology today. Drop by Custom Computers out East or out West. We're open Saturdays from 10 till 4.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
We've been with you from the very start, leading the way and providing you with the best in primetime sporting experiences. From one goal to the next, you can count on us for full access to the best sports channels at home or on the go. Make Rev your only choice. Visit Rev.bs. Every match, every game, every moment. Rev, your home for sports.
America completely run out of it.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We're streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas, Channel 969, and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969. Text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 422-4796. Standard text rates apply. Once again, I'm Dwight Strachan. Joining me on a Tuesday, we've got Laverne Gardner. Laverne, good morning.
Morning.
Great to have you with us. Everybody's a little mixed up this week. We're going to be on location on Thursday, so it's going to be a little challenging with you.
So you're flying me in so I can be on location?
That would have been great. Next time. We'll work that one out.
Okay.
But yeah. All right, so always a pleasure to talk with you. Great to have you with us. Coming up this morning, we're going to get a preview of the Red Ribbon Ball for 2023. It's coming up in just a few weeks, and the AIDS Foundation will be here to tell us all about that. And then later in business, we're talking with the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. World Standards Day was just October 14th. We're going to be talking about that and the work of the Bureau this morning. That's all ahead, but let's begin right now with what's in the news. And in the news, really quickly, before we get to the main thing I want to talk about this morning. So it's happened again. Another man out on bail for murder. Shot and killed right there in broad daylight on the streets. That's how we do it. That's what we like, clearly. And here we go again, right? Boy.
I don't know. We can't say we can't allow them to have bail based on the law, but this doesn't make any sense to me. I think it's clear to everybody that what's happening is vigilante justice, revenge, whatever.
Or a hit squad. One of them.
Something is happening.
But hey.
This isn't just a coincidence.
No. But I guess just, turn your face away and don't get charged with murder, and then you'll be safe. I don't know. I don't know what this is that we're trying to accomplish here. But anyway, here we go again. Big headline: The Guardian today. Chief Passport Officer throws his hat in the ring. Kingsley Smith, a known commodity. Are you familiar with him, Laverne, up there in Grand Bahama?
I know who he is. Yes.
Okay. All right. So he's seeking the PLP nomination. Apparently, he left the FNM and joined the PLP in 2020.
It's
a long list of people back and forth between the two. It's like crossing the street around here. So the Anglican Synod is underway, the 120th session, and Anglican Bishop Leitch Boyd speaking last night, opening the session, appealing to the government again to take VAT off bread basket items. This is interesting what he says here. Of course, saying that this is, harder for some than others. But, quote, my expressed view is that an income tax is fairer since it taxes each citizen in a proportionate way and according to their means. Some may argue that an income-based tax system is more complicated than a value-added tax system, but which is better for the country and the poor in the long term? Another challenge for me is that VAT was decreased from 12% to 10%, which alleviates the strain on the poorer person. However, VAT was then put back on breadbasket items. This is hard for poor people. I know that it is complicated, but could we take VAT back off breadbasket items and offer fruits and vegetables also so that we can allow poorer citizens to eat better and more economically than they are now? I'm not an economist or business person, and so my perspective may not help your bottom line or any number of benchmarks that the business world may need to meet, but we have to take some measures to help the circumstances and improve the living conditions of all. Yeah, Bishop Boyd, not the first to be calling for this, but will anyone pay attention?
I don't know. I'm not hopeful.
And I've been saying for the last few months, with these high electricity bills that we're seeing, can you at least temporarily take the VAT off the electricity bills for everybody?
But, we have to come up with some way to bring relief. It's hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard. It's costly. The electricity bill, I went to the food stores on Saturday, and I'm looking around. I'm looking at my total. I'm looking in my grocery cart. And I'm saying, what is this? What's going on here?
How many items did you have?
Not enough for what my bill was like.
Of course. Of course.
Not enough. I'm like, what?
Yeah. It's insane.
You know, I'm constantly checking. You know, sometimes you go to the grocery store and they give you the total. You just pay and you maybe toss your receipt. Every time they quote me, I'm looking at that receipt. Okay, did we start at zero?
Mm.
Let me make sure.
Yeah, did they put the VAT on twice or something? Right?
Like, what?
Yeah. Well, there's more. Bishop Boyd also speaking about marital rape. And he said, quote, I wish to repeat my wholehearted support for the proposed amendments to the Sexual Offenses Act so that wherever rape occurs, it will be called rape. This movement is not designed to entrap anyone or to take away anyone's rights or privileges. However, like all laws, it is designed to provide protection where needed, where persons may be abused or vulnerable. In a relationship that is wholesome and balanced, such a law will not be necessary. However, we know that there are relationships where there is not equality or mutual respect, and where St. Paul's injunction to husbands and wives in Ephesians 5 is not followed. And what did the Blessed Apostle say there? Ahead of his famous words, quote, wives, be subject to your husbands, and husbands, love your wives the way that Christ loved the church. Before he says these things, he says, be subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. My friends, there are relationships where this does not happen. It is a mistake to present this matter as an attack on men or an attempt to rob husbands or wives of their conjugal rights or an attempt to intrude into the marriage bed or an attempt to give weapon to use against men or women. No, it is none of these, and discussion along these lines only clouds the real germane issue, which is that there are persons who need the protection of the law. Your spouse or partner may not need it, but there are some that do. Remember, laws are not devised for just and loving situations, but for times and places where injustice abounds and the vulnerable are abused and or disadvantaged. You need to frame these words and put them up everywhere so people can read this and think about it. I don't know why some others in the Christian church just can't get this, but we really do appreciate
Bishop Leach Boyd. They do not see it his way. And they will just say what he said is his opinion. And that's just it.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't see it that way.
Well, okay. So that's that. Interesting things going on. So pick up today's NASA Guardian for that. Now, the story that I really want to talk about this morning and yesterday, I'm glad that we got to talk about some other things first so I could calm myself down for this, because this was infuriating to hear this yesterday. Doctor charged with performing abortion. RRT's Davis writing, a Supreme Court judge on Monday granted emergency bail to Dr. Jamil Minnis, the gynecologist accused of performing an abortion on a 15-year-old girl last month. Minnis, the 43-year-old son of former Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis, is charged along with the minor's 48-year-old mother and 25-year-old sister. The women faced charges of conspiracy to commit abortion, and Minnis faced a single count of abortion when they appeared before Senior Magistrate Shaka Serville. The teen's relatives are accused of conspiring to commit the abortion between September 3rd and 4th, and Minnis is alleged to have performed the abortion at his clinic in Harbor Island on September 4th. Damien Gomez Casey, who represents Minnis, along with Cassie Bethel, called for a speedy trial, as he said the allegations could affect his client's professional reputation. is also accused, he's also requested, this is Gomez, requested the teen's medical records and medical records in relation to the fetus. Gomez said, quote, in order to commit abortion, the fetus must be alive. Okay. They were not required to enter pleas to the charges as they will face trial in the Supreme Court. As remanded them to the Bahamas Department of Corrections because he lacked jurisdiction to consider bail for the charges. I mean, I see people all over the internet always saying these things, but that is how it works. Right? They're like, oh, murderer's out on bail. Like this. Pay attention. The Supreme Court has to grant it. So Serville directed police to take the accused to the Central Police Station after being informed that they had applied for emergency bail. The trio then appeared before Justice Wilhelmina Archer at about 2:30, Archer Mins, at about 2:30 p.m. for the bail hearing, which was closed to the public. The bail application was deemed an emergency because the prosecution didn't object to their release. The accused were each granted $15,000 bail with signed-in conditions. Okay, so Ian Cargill and Cassie Bethel appeared for minutes at the bail hearing, and Heather Hunt represented the women. Now, this part is very important here. Meanwhile, 25-year-old Alonzo Pinder, who allegedly got the teen pregnant, 25, she's 15, 25, right, was formally charged with unlawful sexual intercourse back on September 11th. Prosecutors alleged that he had relations with the teen between 2023 and July 31st. Justice Jeanine Wish Gomez granted Pinder of $9,500 bail on September 26th. Okay. Let's talk. What do you make of this case? Abortion is illegal in the Bahamas. Yes. Should it be illegal? It comes up occasionally when we hear stories like this. But do we need to not only talk about this once in a while, but with especially a by-election coming, and most of us have never heard any of our elected officials give their views on this, is it time for this to become a major issue when we go to the polls? Let's talk about this and this case. What say you on this? Laverne, I want to hear from you, but folks, give us a call, 323-6232, 325-4316. 325-4259. Call us toll free, 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. She's not 25, she's not 27, she's not 30, she's 15. 15 years
old. Why do you go so high? She's not 20.
Nah, okay. She's not an adult. She's 15.
She's not an adult. She's a child. She's a minor. She's 15 years old. He is a minor, and this is a big, grown man.
Yeah.
Come on. Like, when do we get to the point where we say it's enough of this?
And making this situation even more complicated is the fact of who he is. Is this what's really happening here? Because we know that abortions are taking place in this country. Illegal or not? Is this a political thing? So that's another wrinkle in this complicated story. But let's talk about it plainly. Is it time for this madness to stop now? We note that yesterday on Twitter, ZNS did a poll asking people should in cases of unlawful sexual assault or intercourse, should the folks who become pregnant, women who become pregnant, they said individuals, and that riled people up too. But anyway, should individuals who become pregnant have the right to...
Individuals? Anyway, go ahead.
Well, you know...
I'm sorry.
So some people got worked up by that.
We're not going to go there.
I figure perhaps they may think if you're a minor, especially, this is not just you. It's going to be the parents. It's going to be the family members. So maybe, yes, right. Individuals, maybe. Should folks be... be able to get an abortion in cases like that? And for some reason, that riled people up, not just because of the word individuals, but I think people were angry that ZNS was asking such a question, which didn't make any sense. I think
right.
It was a great question.
You know what? We get so offended about the questions. I wish we would. We we would put some of that energy behind the actual thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We get so offended. How? Why are you asking that question? Let's not pretend for a minute that it's not happening already.
And some of the people seem to believe that this is, that this would be something that would be allowed. Then I don't know if they understand the law of this country.
Right.
Mixing it up with other places.
The law does not, in its current form, does not allow for abortion under any circumstance.
I think unless the mother's life is unless in grave danger.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so if it doesn't fall under that category, it's illegal.
Yeah.
It's interesting to me that this case came up to the forefront, and very interesting based on who was charged.
Of course. And again, but, people are wondering if that's the only reason why someone's been charged here. We cannot recall in recent times a doctor being charged.
The incident with the 11-year-old.
Yeah, the mother was charged.
The mother was charged.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But let's go right here. We see that his lawyer, is asking for her medical record.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason he's saying is, in order for it to be considered an abortion, the fetus has to be alive.
Well, lawyers are going to lawyer, right? So I don't know what that is about. We don't have to get...
Wait, I'm
so
just saying.
It's interesting.
I don't know. What does that mean? Mm. Does it mean that this childhood already miscarried?
All right. So let's... I don't know.
I'm trying to figure out what angle he's going at.
Well, let's stick to just the basic premise here that a doctor's been charged with performing an abortion on a teenager. And let's get the public's views on this. Let's go to the phone lines and hear what you have to say about this. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Morning, Dwight. How are you?
Doing well.
Good morning to your guests.
Morning.
Okay, now let me tell you the several things that disturbs me about this case. The first thing is that we have a lot of antiquated laws in this country that just need to be done away with, this being one of them, abortion being one of them. Secondly, I listened to this, and I couldn't believe it. So the guy who allegedly had sex with the girl was released on, what, $9,500 bail?
Yes, less
the
than what the...
The doctor was released on $15,000 bail.
Yeah.
So to me, it's like, which is the bigger crime?
Mm.
I mean, this is a 15-year-old, like you said. If she delivered this baby, the pressure is going to be on the parents, the grandparents.
Well, you know, according to the law, they're going to say this is essentially murder. So that
takes us back to the fact that there are a lot of antiquated laws in this country that needs to be done away with.
Well, you see, the problem is you and I say that, and maybe Laverne too, but there are a whole lot of people who are very much opposed to abortion.
Okay.
We've had pastors on this show say that even if their wives and daughters were raped and got pregnant, they would have to carry that baby to term.
Dwight, on that point, I want to say this. The government, neither the church, should be allowed to dictate morality, especially considering that they have none.
Wow.
Okay? So all of these people who are still living in the Stone Age, they need to get over it. The laws are old and they do not speak to issues that we deal with today.
Okay.
Something has to be done. From time to time, we keep on coming back to the same story, but no one is pressing the button and say, okay, time to sit down and let's look at these things seriously. Because that, I might as well tell you, I have two daughters, and if something like that was to happen to one of them, you could bet your last dollar that goes without saying, that baby's not coming forward.
Mm.
It's not happening.
Okay.
Because you have to think of the future ramifications. What happens to this child now, 15-year-old child raising a child? What happens to the family? Suppose they're already in a financial situation where they could barely feed themselves. So that means because of some stupid antiquated laws, we have to bring another child in the world to suffer, to be a burden on the government, to be a burden on society. I mean, there's all kind of other things. And you know what? And people like to say life begins in the womb. right? But guess what? We all are going to answer to God for our own sins. Do not dictate or do not put your view. Stop me, because your view is say, oh, you shouldn't have an abortion. That doesn't apply to me. We don't think alike. Yeah. And these laws, they need to really, really need to be looked at. I'm just so angry. The fact, and you know what? What's so funny is they couldn't wait to publish it and say, oh, this is Dr. Minister's son.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, okay, only because it's Dr. Minister's son, you have to publish, make sure I publish his name. Like, yeah, he did something. Come on, man.
Well, you know how the police stopped telling the media that they were going to bring somebody to court because they didn't want to do the parade? Well, they certainly did it this time. They said, oh, we're bringing a doctor in.
Okay.
So this is very suspicious.
That there was politically motivated. Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just so, every time I think about the nonsense that goes on in this country, things that those in authority see that can be fixed just by the stroke of a pen or even a referendum if need be. But it's like they sit on their brain. They are so reactive rather than proactive.
Yeah.
It's just sickening at this point, Dwight. Sick of it.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Appreciate it. Again, I know a lot of people are going to say it's antiquated. They're going to say it's not. And point to other places that are rolling back abortion rights.
And that's why it's never going to be something that political parties, people running, that they're going to campaign on, that they're going to talk about.
Yeah, but they might not want to. But we got to make them. We need to find out where they stand. We do. This needs to be an issue, even with this by-election. Like, where do you stand on this? It's time.
You really think that's going to happen, Dwight?
Yeah, if we make it, ask. Hey, what's your view, Shane Gibson? What's your view? What's his name? Kingsley Smith? Whoever else says they're running. What's your view on this? Let's hear.
Well, we don't know if any of them are going to run, right?
Ask everybody. Ask everyone. And ask everyone going forward. Let's hear. Why? Why do you think that? What's your view of marital rape? Let's hear this. We need to know. We need to know. Let's take another call. Good morning, Carl.
Good morning, Dwight and Laverne. How are you?
Doing well.
Good.
Good morning.
You know, this issue, it's up to the forefront now, and it needs to be discussed. It needs to be discussed because it's now, you know, because this has been going on for, they don't use the term abortion, but it's been going on from, I was a teenager way back then, and it's been happening, and so many doctors, you know, and I, you know, don't want to say as far as political or whatever, he just happened to be the doctor that got caught up in this whole mess, this unfortunate situation with this, yeah, with the teenager, I think, right? And it got so much publicity, I think, it's why it's happened. Because, and if they're going to call him before the courts for doing something like this, for doing that, being accused, then the line would be out to the streets with other okay?
Mm.
Who have been doing it and who have been doing this and who are continuing to do this. But this issue needs to be, because the first thing you're going to say, right, when you say you are asked, this should be a part of the discussion with future candidates, right?
Yeah.
You know what some of them are going to say? This issue is a non-style of me or whatever, because it's already on the books.
All right, and then the Bahamian people need to act accordingly. And the Bahamian people need to act, whoever's asking to challenge them and say, well, okay.
Right, it needs to be amended. There has to be another look at this whole abortion issue,
mm-hmm.
okay, in relation to the time, how many months, you understand, the fetus or has it been developed or, you know, how late or how long the term is, or there should be discussions as far as whether the mother or the child is in, you know, at risk. They should take this down, and I would love to hear from the rights groups on this, you know, or the Minister of Health to have to open discussions on this particular, because this, trust me, like you said, this is a hot topic right now. And it's going to get even just as big as, I think, immigration. This is something, because of what happened yesterday, it's going to be huge, and we need to have more discussions on this as to the baby going forward with this situation. Because I don't think it's fair for this doctor to be brought before the courts.
Yeah.
As far as because of and it's been one.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Have a safe day.
Appreciate it. You too. Let's take one more call, and then we'll get to a couple of your messages. Then we need to take a break. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
Hi. Good morning, Laverne. How are you now?
Morning.
Laverne?
Yes.
Oh, good morning. Dwight, it's two things, and I'm going to be really quick about it. If anybody expects, because of the names mentioned in that release, and it's everywhere in print, on the news stations, and I guess that's how you guys get it, so that's how it reads. Anything but our political immaturity or just our immaturity as behemoths, then I don't know what to tell you. But, Dwight, look at the numbers. There are more women of voting age in the country. And check the Department of Statistics. Head of households, what else? If you look at the workforce here, our females far outnumber our men. The fact that females in the Bahamas are marginalized, it has to be deferred back to the women of this country. Your previous caller said about asking to be a part of the discussion. Ask if you have the numbers. It doesn't get any simpler than that. Thanks for taking my call, Dwight.
Okay. I mean, you do need to ask because you need to know where they stand, but I hear you. But are women voting like that? Are men voting like that? Does it make a difference? Right? We find out after the fact, after people have been in office for two years, where they stand on an issue that's of great importance to a lot of people, which is very, very shocking.
I think what he's saying is that because there are more women than men, our voices should be louder. On these issues, especially if they impact us the most.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's not happening.
Right. Because again, nobody's asking. You know? Nobody's asking. And they don't feel they have to have an opinion on this or anything. Anything. Nobody the only does. Thing politicians like say is, oh, we need more jobs. We need more jobs.
If we're not asking, then that is telling the candidate that that's interested in.
Right. Yeah.
When they come campaigning, you're not saying, what is your stand on X, Y, Z?
Mm-hmm.
What is your, if we're not saying that, if we're just trying to, in some instances, just get by because we need a job. Because nobody's working, because that's the most, you know, and the reality is for some people, that is what is most important to them,
yeah.
Right? Because financially, they are in distress. And so that is their focus. But if we're not asking them this, then we're not requiring them to have an opinion. And then when they are up in the house and these things come up and we hear them expressing their beliefs, and then we're shocked, we're dismayed.
Mm.
But those aren't the things on our list. And for some of us, we don't ask any questions because regardless of what they believe, we've already made a determination that that's who we're going to vote for based on the fact that they're running for the party that we support,
yeah.
Right? So we don't have questions for them. What we do is we have a chit-chat, we have a laugh, maybe we talk about the opposition or whoever else. And it's like, don't worry, you straight. I have four votes in here and they're all for you.
Mm. Wow. All right, let's take this call, and then we're going to go to the break. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Laverne.
Hi.
Good morning.
Morning. I just want to ask a question. not that it's on the book as illegal. And then I think somebody said, unless the mother is at risk or the fetus is at risk.
I think you can make a case.
Is that? Does the doctor determine that? Or does he have to go before a judge to determine whether to take the child? And we have a medical board over here. So this is. And you guys were saying, well, sounds politically motivated. It really does. But how long have I been listening to your response? Thanks again.
Yeah. Again, this perhaps is why Damon Gomez is saying we need the files, right? But this is crazy. And while it's many will disagree on whether the law is antiquated, the way we deal with it, like the previous caller said, the way we deal with it and not wreck is antiquated. That's silly. And we need to really grow up and address this once and for all. You might not want a blanket approach to it, to abortion, but you need to allow in certain circumstances. We see many of you are saying this on your messages, this one here. This is a tough one. If you are under 16, you can't give consent. Thus, it's considered rape or unlawful sexual intercourse. If I were a mother and my 15-year-old was raped, I wouldn't consent to her carrying that baby to term, which probably goes against my Christian beliefs, but there you have it, right? What do you do here? Why would you do this? Why would you inflict that on this child? And people will say all manner of other things, I'm sure, in relation to that. But we really have to come to terms with this and address this once and for all. Once and for all. Let's see if we can squeeze this call in before we go to the break. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Morning, Dwight. Good morning, Laverne.
Hi.
Morning.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. You only tell me happy birthday?
Oh, happy birthday.
Yeah, happy birthday. I beg it for that. But listen.
How young are you today?
But for people who buy a number, 060, the big 60.
Oh, okay, congratulations.
Yeah, man, thanks. But listen, I totally agree with the first caller. He really brought it on. But Dwight, what we really should be asking, and Laverne, is are there laws, because I really never heard of any, that in mitigating circumstances such as that, do we have laws where doctors or parents can make that type of decision but based on, you know, like a medical problem or rape problem or underage problem? Do we have those laws out there? That's what we need to find out. Now, another thing, Dwight, I want to tell you.
Well, we know it's happening. We know it's happening, whether the law, but we know it's happening. And if you come in there and both are dying, they're going to make a decision.
You have to make a decision.
And
yeah,
that happens I don't know if every day, but it's happening a lot.
Yeah, well, that's what I wanted to know, because mm-hmm. like one of your callers said, man, this thing actually was a hammer. You know, I brought people, but anyway, I want to say that.
What now?
But something right quick I want to say, Dwight. I spoke to two nurses yesterday at the hospital. You remember the COVID situation where the government was asking the nurses to volunteer their services to go on the COVID front line and that they would be compensated? Dwight, Laverne, do you know some of those nurses have not been paid yet?
My goodness.
The governments or ministers may think those nurses, those things are under the rug, but those nurses are still reeling and complaining that they haven't been paid. Those nurses put their lives on the line, right? Mm-hmm. We lost some of them.
Yeah.
And they haven't paid. Suppose, like 52, to say, my schoolmate, they say, we have another pandemic. How do you expect those nurses to put their services forward, man?
Mm.
Man, the minister, you all need to do something with that. Right, thanks for taking my call.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Curious of the nurses' union, we're not hearing that problem, but if that is the case, that is shameful. All right, let's take the break, and we're going to pick up the discussion on the other side. A whole lot of text messages coming in. We want to get more of your views on this. This is Morning Blend on a Tuesday morning here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
People living like they ain't got no mamas. I think the whole world's addicted to the drama. Only attracted to things that'll bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we trying to stop terrorism. But we still got terrorists here living in the USA. The big CIA, the Bloods and the Crips and the KKK. But if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate. And to discriminate only generates hate. And when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, madness is what you demonstrate. And that's exactly how anger works and operates. Man, you gotta have love just to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all.
People killing, people dying, children hurt and you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach and what you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us and some guidance. These people got me questioning. Where is the love?
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
It is time for your first good traffic for the morning, brought to you by RBC. Start your home journey with an RBC mortgage today. In your real-time traffic at this hour, we've got a number of hotspots to tell you about. The usual hotspots, we've got Eastern Road, heavy traffic from just west of San Susie Road now, straight to Johnson Road. You're going to see that slow-moving traffic westbound for this morning. Alternate routes look better, even Bernard Road this morning, and Prince Charles Drive until you get to about Beatrice Avenue, and especially on the way to Soldier Road. And from there on, things are not looking good for you. Robinson Road backed up, heavy traffic from between Soldier straight up to East-West Highway. So you through that intersection straight north to the intersection with, well, actually straight through to Village Road. So that's past Bernard and Wolf Road. Heavy traffic there. Further west, we've got Blue Hill Road. Lots of issues there. Heavy traffic from Carmichael straight up to the roundabout with Independence Drive. And then Milo Butler Highway, of course, from well south of the Fire Trail roundabout straight up to Tonic Williams Darling Highway roundabout. That's northbound. And a bit of congestion at the termination point for Milo Butler Highway near Faith Avenue and Carmichael Road. So those are your hot spots. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert. We'll have another one for you after the 8 o'clock news. Morning Blend traffic brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with RBC today. And time for another check of your traffic for this morning, of your weather now. Weather for this morning brought to you by Easy Car Sales. This morning, don't get used to it though, but a stationary front sits across the southeast Bahamas that's producing showers and thunderstorms along and ahead of the frontal boundary, while pressure, high pressure, will continue to build behind the front with cool and stable conditions across the northwest and central islands. Beachgoers, though, being advised to stay out of the water due to rough surf and the risk of rip currents along North Coast beaches, and boaters should be alert for waterspout activity near the frontal boundary. Your forecast for today for the northwest and central Bahamas, variably cool and cloudy, with a slight chance of isolated showers through tonight. Small craft caution in effect due to swells. For the southeast Bahamas, variably cloudy and cool with scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms. Small craft caution in effect due to swells again. Temperatures today, highs around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to a comfortable 70 Fahrenheit, 21 Celsius. You might even be able to open the windows and turn off the AC. Who knows? But not for long, because over the next couple of days, that front is expected to remain across the southeast Bahamas before eventually dissipating by Thursday. High pressure will continue to build behind the front, and winds will once again increase across the islands. It's going to mean variably cloudy and breezy conditions with a chance of a passing isolated shower in the northwest Bahamas, partly cloudy and a bit breezy, with widely scattered showers and thunderstorms in the central and southeastern islands. Then Thursday, variably cloudy and a bit breezy with a chance of passing isolated showers in the northwest Bahamas, partly cloudy and a bit breezy with widely scattered showers and thunderstorms in the central and southeast Bahamas, and that warming trend returning. We'll have your look at the tropics coming up after our weather check after the 8 o'clock news. But this weather check brought to you by Easy Car Sales. Ready to break free from the pump? Well, visit Easy Car Sales and take the wheel of an electric vehicle. It's not just a test drive, it's a revolution. Dump the pump and drive electric. Visit easy242.com.
Whether you're looking for your first or new home, or even using your existing home as equity, RBC understands that your journey to home ownership is unique and you'll mortgage that. That is why at RBC, we have dedicated mortgage specialists that provide sound advice and helpful solutions to make your dream home a reality. Best of all, the RBC mortgage team is mobile, flexible, and will meet you almost anywhere. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with an RBC mortgage specialist.
We've been with you from the very start, leading the way and providing you with the best in primetime sporting experiences.
From Nassau, Bahamas, time June.
From one goal to the next, you can count on us for full access to the best sports channels at home or on the go. Make Rev your only choice. Visit Rev.bs. Every match, every game, every moment. Rev, your home for sports.
America completely run out of it.
Wherever you are in the world, Cleveland Clinic's world-class care is here for you. From Ohio to Florida to London, Cleveland Clinic treats thousands of patients every year. Ranked number 2 in the world by Newsweek, you can trust our caregivers to enhance your experience across each step of your treatment journey. For every care in the world, learn more at clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
You've tried everything. ASUS, with your mother's cousin's sister's auntie, and even hiding your money under your mattress. But is your money safe? Your Bahamian dollar deposit in a member bank or credit union is insured up to $50,000. If anything happens, your deposit up to the insured value will be returned to you thanks to Deposit Insurance. Visit Deposit Insurance Corporation at www.dic.bf.
Protection for your money, guaranteed with DIC.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio, 96.9. We're streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at morningblend969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 422-4796. Standard text rates apply. Now at 8:21, time for another check of your weather for today. Mind Insurance. We've got a stationary front that's across the southeast Bahamas that's producing showers and thunderstorms along and ahead of the boundary. And high pressure will continue to build behind the front with cool and stable conditions across the northwest and central Bahamas. Beachgoers being advised to stay out of the water, especially along the north coast islands, well, north coast of the islands, as there's a risk of rough surf and dangerous rip currents. And boaters should be alert for water spot activity near the frontal boundary as well. For today, for the northwest and central Bahamas, your forecast calls for variably cloudy and cool conditions with a slight chance of isolated showers through tonight. Small craft caution in effect due to swells. For the southeast Bahamas, variably cloudy and cool with scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms through tonight. Again, small craft caution in effect due to swells. Temperatures very comfortable, highs getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 70 Fahrenheit, 21 Celsius. In your extended outlook, the front is expected to remain across the southeast Bahamas before eventually dissipating by Thursday, and higher temperatures will return after that point. High pressure continues to build behind the front, though, and winds will once again increase across the islands. So for Wednesday, tomorrow, variably cloudy and a bit breezy with a chance of passing isolated showers in the northwestern islands. Partly cloudy and a bit breezy with widely scattered showers and thunderstorms in the central and southeast Bahamas. Thursday, variably cloudy, a bit breezy, chance of passing isolated showers in the northwestern islands. Partly cloudy, a bit breezy with widely scattered showers and thunderstorms in the central and southeast Bahamas. In the tropics, we're still watching that broad area of low pressure over the central tropical Atlantic. Formation chance has gone up a bit now. It's about 80% chance through the next 7 days. That one. But that is your morning blend weather check brought to you by First Online Insurance. Morning Blend weather, again, brought to you by First Online Insurance, powered by Bahamas First at firstonlineinsurance.com. You can choose your agent, get a quote, and buy your home or auto insurance 100% online, firstonlineinsurance.com. And time for another check of your traffic for the morning, brought to you by RBC. Start your home journey with an RBC mortgage today. In your real-time traffic, things still pretty busy for you on Milo Butler Highway from well south of Fire Trail straight up to Tawnique Williams Darling Highway. You're going to see that heavy traffic in the northbound lanes there. Traffic backed up a bit for you along Tawnique Williams Darling Highway as well. Elsewhere, we've got Carmichael Road heavy, building traffic eastbound toward Blue Hill Road, and Blue Hill from that point straight up to Independence Drive, heavy traffic for you northbound. East Street also busy for you from about Sappadell Boulevard straight through to the roundabout with East-West Highway and Independence Drive, pretty much onto the intersection with Robinson Road, especially if you're northbound this morning. Sold Road, a number of issues. We've got near Old Trail and straight through to the intersection with Robinson and Prince Charles Drive and further up with Bernard Wolf and Village Road. Back to Prince Charles Drive and Robinson Road. Heavy, heavy traffic for you between Soldier and East-West Highway. That's westbound, and that's causing traffic to be backed up along Old Trail as well. Massey for you this morning, northbound. Eastern Road is looking better at this point. Some traffic just west of Foxhill Road, still up to about Johnson Road. Those are your hot spots. That's your real-time traffic and your morning blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with RBC today.
Too many debt bills? Overdue on loan payments? Improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Shrink your debt payments with a debt consolidation loan and built-in savings that pays you 5% interest. Call 356-7764.
There's a new electric vehicle in town. The Jack brand of SUVs, trucks, sedans, and commercial vans, available only at Easy Car Sales, home of the fully electric vehicle. For a powerful, smooth ride at a fraction of the cost to drive, leave the pump behind and hit the road with Jack. Visit easy242.com to see our brand new Jack models and drop into Easy Car Sales for a test drive. It'll have you singing.
Hit the road with Jack and don't you pump gas no more.
The Access Accelerator Small Business Development Center is here to help small businesses throughout the entire Bahamas. To better serve you, we've made it easier to contact us. Call 461-7232, WhatsApp 359-0626 or 359-2394, email helpdesk@sbdcbahamas.com or submit a ticket when you visit our help center at accessaccelerator.org. The Access Accelerator, empowering small business.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM.
National. You're killing people, dying, children hurting, and crying. Can you practice what you preach and what you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning. Where is the love?
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan along with Laverne Gardner on this Tuesday morning. And we're having a very interesting discussion about abortion and abortion rights, legalizing, whether we shouldn't. And before the break, Laverne, I said we need to really have the discussion to take into account the nuances in these situations, like if somebody's underage, if rape or incest is involved, right? If somebody's life is in danger, all these things need to be taken into consideration. And the blanket approach to abortion might not be entirely helpful. All right, so I'm having an interesting conversation with a dear friend. I'm going to read this. I don't think he's going to mind, but I'm going to read this. So he heard me say that and said, please list for me the nuances and mitigating circumstances that would justify the murder of Dwight Strachan in the womb. You hearing this, Laverne? Yeah? Laverne, you with us? Did we lose you?
Sorry. No, I'm here. I was on mute. I'm sorry. I was saying I'm listening.
Okay. So, right, please list for me the nuances and mitigating circumstances that would justify the murder of Dwight Strachan in the womb. I responded, well, if my mother were raped by her father, brother, cousin, or some nasty up the street, yeah, please spare her and me of a life like that. And he counters, well, would not the world be robbed of such a wonderful, bright, and promising individual as yourself? And I said, I guarantee you I would not be the person I am today had I been the product of incest or rape. And I went on to say some other things that I don't think I should read on air, but let's get your views on that. What do we think? And he's saying that some other people have come from worse circumstances and have been able to overcome this and are thriving and living wonderful lives. And I'm sure that is the case.
Well, which is true in some instances.
Yes, but I'm sure there are many, 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 many examples of where this has all gone wrong. Where either the mother, yes, the mother might give, and then that's what people say, well, just give the child up for adoption. But, I mean, as we see, that can present many, many, many other challenges as well, especially in a foster system or a home system that these kids are at disadvantage from day one. So we've got many examples of good and bad that can come out of this. I know many, many see this as murder. Many do. And we are not all going to agree on this at all. But, all right, let's take these calls. And then I need to get to the text messages. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Mr. Dwight Strachan. How you doing?
Doing well.
Sparky, and morning, guest. You know, my personal view on this, Dwight, this abortion thing, is I believe that should be up to the women of our nation and the medical staff of our nation. I don't think that should be left up to no lawyers, no politicians, not nobody. I think the women should get together and decide what they would like to have. Should they find themselves in a situation, a young girl at 15, raped by 3-4 men, not of her own willing, and find out that a month later she's lost a period, or whatever that menstrual cycle, and is pregnant. I think it's between that lady and her mother, because that baby coming along the line is going to scar her for the rest of her life. Her life has completely changed.
All right, but Sparky, you will need the lawyers, because they need to remove the law that's making it.
To make the law.
Yes, exactly.
We need them to make the law.
Yes.
But I think the women should get together and look at, this is my 15-year-old daughter. I'm planning her education. I'm planning her life.
Mm-hmm.
She don't know what to do with no baby. And I'm an old woman. I can't take care of no baby. I'm trying to take care of my daughter.
Right.
I got to take care of my grandchild with a daughter of 15 and a grandchild on the way.
Yeah.
Let us make up our mind what we want to do and take it to our representative and then make the law.
Yes.
Because what we want to happen, should we reach on that situation like that?
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
And that's the end of it. Have a good day.
Well, sounds simple, but it won't be. It won't be. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You are on the air. Good morning. Hi, are you there? Yes? No? Okay. Let's read some of your messages. This person says here, I don't think the abortion debate should be attached to the case of a raped teen. I'm pro-choice, by the way, and think abortion should be available. Well, I don't understand the first part of your text, but okay. I think... Oh, okay. This person says here, how come no doctor got charged with performing on the 11-year-old girl? Well, because the mother did it. You know, the mother administered that.
The mother gave her something.
Yes.
But where did she get the something from?
Well... And what was it? But she was charged.
Right.
Mm-hmm. This person says, Dwight, abortions were taking place in this form from time into and will be into eternity, I think they're saying, with senior doctors performing the procedure. I'm wondering if this is political. Yes, many are indeed. Another one says here, only the fake play Christians will get offended with these questions. I guess that's earlier when we said we need to ask everybody running for office what are their views on these things, abortion and marital rape, et cetera, et cetera.
I think what we need to do along those lines, and I'm talking about individuals, don't wait until the heat of election season, because everybody just is, you know, when things come up, issues that are important to you, issues that impact you as an individual, that impact your family, these are the things that you need to be making a note of. These are the things that you need to write down so that when people come around and they're saying, you know, can I count on you for your support? You are then saying to yourself, what are you in line with these things that I believe in? Do we share the same beliefs? Is this important to you? And begin to ask these questions. Make it now, because we get emotional and feel a certain way about these things. And then election comes along and we're sidetracked by whatever we're sidetracked by.
Mm-hmm.
Well, these issues don't come up and then we're just discussing over and over again.
Well, the challenge is most of the candidates pop up days before the election. Like, I'm running for your constituency. Like, who are you?
No.
What?
Maybe some of the independent candidates.
Really?
Some of the independent candidates. No. But these are more seasoned parties. They know who they're going to run where. Once that person has been ratified and that person has been announced, they have people on the ground even prior to that doing
Six
the work.
Weeks?
So
6 weeks.
You have enough time to ask the questions that you want to ask.
Okay.
So prepare in advance. Have your list.
In any event, have the list and ask the questions. Absolutely.
And ask the questions.
This person says, why are we focusing on the doctors? We had a mother and a sister that facilitated death. Stop trying to legalize killing just because the culprit is a woman. If a man kills a man in cold-blooded murder, it's cold-blooded murder. If a woman kills a baby, the law needs to change. Suck my teeth. No focus on the mother. The mother was charged, as was the sister, so I don't know what you're saying. But okay, I hear you. I agree with you, but...
we really just focus on the doctor. We just said it was interesting.
Yes.
How the doctor. This was so publicized so quickly.
Yeah.
That is what we said.
And as have been saying, it's been going on forever, and many prominent doctors have been known to perform these things here. So this is odd. This person says, I think some people are missing the point. It's not about the abortion. She's 15 years old. It's against the law to have sex with a 15-year-old. So who is the father? We just told you the alleged father. The doctor has a legal obligation to report a crime, don't they? Is it a relative? They are trying. No, you're not listening. We read the whole.
No,
everything
we did,
is there.
We did say
the person's already been charged.
25-year-old man.
Mm-hmm.
I think his name is Alonzo Pinder.
Oh, you remember all that? Let's see.
Yes, Dwight, I remember all of that. And so we did say that.
Yes, that's right. He's out on bail. Mm-hmm. 25-year-old. Okay.
$9,600 bail, eh?
Or 500, 9,005.
You're 500,
keeping track. Great. This person says, if I were the child's mother in this instance, my first call would have been to the police and my second to the gynecologist to have the pregnancy terminated. I would have considered the second call as important as the first. Strangely, the legality of it would not have occurred to me. It's never discussed as a crime in the Bahamas. What? Don't start punishing the doctors. This is not the right direction to be headed in. This one says here, listen, I can't believe that our government determines what happens with a woman's body. I never knew abortion was illegal. Really? I told you, Laverne, I think based on some of the comments that some people had in response to that poll question yesterday, clearly a lot of people don't know this is illegal because they know so many people. Well, what type of question is this? But folks, it's illegal in the Bahamas. This one says, are they asking questions comes back to freedom of information? Really? We lack access to... this is not the same thing. We lack access to information for data analysts independent of the government to determine where issues exist and possible solutions. We are challenged to compare ourselves to other societies. Well, I mean, that's true, but that's not what we're talking about here. Just trying to get a view of the people running for office's views on things. Right? So it's a little bit different. You don't have to request a Freedom of Information document to find out whether you are pro-choice or against abortion. Well, I would hope not. This one says, this is a rotten political witch hunt. When will we all grow up in this country?
Which part is the witch hunt?
I guess the doctor part. Well, maybe you're right. Maybe. Mm-hmm. Which part indeed. Listen to your callers. Listen to all your callers. It's only the men calling. We had one woman call so far. But this is a woman's issue. Ask the women callers if they agree or disagree, if they would call. And that's part of the problem. The women are not being vocal on this matter. And that's been the case that do impact women for the most part. This texture says here, if we leave it up to the women, then the morality police, the men, won't have any control over the women's bodies, and you know they will never allow that. Wow. All right, we're running out of time. Let me just read a few more of these. These texters are something else. They're calling some names of some deceased doctors. I don't know why. They just say, you remember this person who was a gynecologist, and that's it. So you can take from that what you wish. I'm not going to read the name on the air. This one says, I listen to your show quite a bit, and I'm always baffled that people are more upset over marital rape and abortion than over all the other crimes that occur daily in this country. Okay. All right. Another one, I'm curious as to how the news of a most likely privately done procedure got out, hence making it political. I'm wondering, Laverne and I were talking about that as well. What? How did this happen? Who did this? And what was their motivation? That is quite something. And boy, I hope we find out. And this one says it's not...
It'll be interesting. Yeah. It'll be interesting to find out who reported it.
Yeah, definitely.
You know. But go ahead.
Yeah. This one says it's not... It's the not women's body that's being mutilated and ripped apart. It's the babies. We cannot have sin create more sin. Conception via rape is the lesser percentage of abortion farmed together to care for the child and rape victim, not select who we want to be born. And I am a woman. Okay. Someone says here... So a woman being assaulted, carrying an unwanted pregnancy for 9 months, suffering through childbirth, is worth it all for an unwanted baby? I'm a woman. I work for government, so I don't want people to hear my voice. Okay, so they're texting. When did murder become a woman's issue? Tell me. Wow. And somebody's asking how old was the fetus. Let's take this one final call, and then we got to move on. Good morning, caller on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning to your guest. Is that Laverne this morning?
Yes, it is.
This is Laverne.
Good morning, Laverne.
Hi.
Listen, I'm listening to the texts and so on, but I'm still waiting to hear when the person that slept with that 15-year-old is going to be arrested. They was quick to arrest the doctor and the mother.
You're tuning in late. We've told you about this already.
He was charged.
A 25-year-old allegedly got the teen pregnant, was formally charged with unlawful sexual intercourse back on September 11th. Prosecutors alleged that he had relations with the teen between June 1st and July 31st. He was granted $9,500 bail on September 26th.
Okay, yes, I did tune in very late there because I was thinking about that. You think it might have been him or one of his family members that reported it? Because he might have wanted to keep the child.
And that would be sick. He's 25 and she's 15. And that says a lot. If it is that, we don't know, but has crossed my mind.
Yeah, because I'm still trying to figure out how to get out. That sounds like a private procedure. I don't know how to get out, but okay.
All right. Well, we're going to leave that there. The conversation needs to continue, though. We need to come to some understanding about this. It just can't pop up every couple of months and then just disappear, right? This is something the Bahamian people are going to have to face and decide once and for all what we're going to do with abortion. All right, so we'll keep you posted on this story, of course. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're changing gears. We're going to get a preview of the upcoming Red Ribbon Ball. It's right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Have love to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all.
People killing, people dying, children hurting, you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach and what you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning. Where is the love?
Whether you're looking for your first or new home, or even using your existing home as equity, RBC understands that your journey to home ownership is unique, and your mortgage financing should reflect that. That is why, at RBC, we have dedicated mortgage special advice and helpful solutions to make your dream home a reality. Best of all, the RBC mortgage team is mobile, flexible, and will meet you almost anywhere. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with an RBC mortgage specialist.
There's a new electric vehicle in town, the Jack brand of SUVs, trucks, sedans, and commercial vans, available only at Easy Car Sales, home of the fully electric vehicle. For a powerful, smooth ride at a fraction of the cost to drive, and hit the road with Jack. Visit easy242.com to see our brand new Jack models and drop into Easy Car Sales for a test drive. It'll have you singing.
Hit the road with Jack, and don't you pump gas no more.
It's been 35 years since Custom Computers was founded, and we'd like to celebrate that milestone by thanking you, our clients and customers. You've inspired 35 years of expert service and support, partnering with the world's leading brands like HP, Apple, and Microsoft. We take pride in setting the bar for what you expect and deserve from a homegrown Bahamian business. We're here to serve you when you need us, so call 396-1101. Custom Computers, raising the standard since 1987.
Take some advice from your Aunt Angie. If you're going to invest in an exotic pet, choose anything but a Norwegian forest cat. Apparently, they will eat all your jewelry. Before you know it, you're racing to the vet when your cat escapes from his carrier and lunges for your earrings. You crash, and your cat swallows your pearls. Mm-hmm. But if you're smart, you'll have CG Motor Insurance and get the best comprehensive coverage for the price.
Get the best comprehensive coverage for the price. CG Atlantic Insurance Agents and Brokers. Good like that. All benefits are subject to policy provisions, including...
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL. Growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
It's the Battle of the Bra, sponsored by Canoe, and you decide who wins. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so strap on your gloves and join the fight. It's easy. Just download the Canoe app, vote for Mammogram Access Program, the Grand Bahama Cancer Society, or Sister Sister, or go to the Battle of the Bra event page on Facebook and vote. Each vote is just $5. Polls open on October 2nd and close on October 26th. Vote as many times as you want. You can even vote for all three. It's the Battle of the Bra. The winner will be announced on Friday, October 27th at the Pink Lotus Affair at Blair House.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan along with Laverne Gardner. All right, so we're changing gears now, getting away from that. We'll talk about that more over the next few weeks. But it's back and coming up quickly, the Red Ribbon Ball One of the major fundraisers for the Bahamas AIDS Foundation, here to tell us all about this. Very pleased to welcome back to the show, Lady Camille Barnett and
Aramae
Ford Strawn. Good morning. Great to have you both with us again.
Thank you.
Morning.
Wonderful to be
morning.
Here.
Morning.
All right, so before we get into this year's theme, Lady Barnett, remind everybody about the work of the Bahamas AIDS Foundation and why the Red Ribbon Ball is so important.
Yes, absolutely. Well, first of all, we had the pandemic, and that really destroyed a lot of nonprofit organizations. So it's been 3 years since we've had the ball, which is a major fundraiser, and a lot of work was discontinued. So, for example, we had to release 13 persons from the organization as a result of COVID. We're down to a skeleton staff. We still have our social worker, thank goodness, and she's been trying to do what she could by herself. Before the pandemic hit, we were feeding our kids 5 days a week. They came to us. We helped them. They got access to the social worker, a psychologist, tutors to help them with their work, skill development, life skills, survival skills, all of that. And as a result of the pandemic, we had to stop a lot of that.
Wow. And how many kids?
We had, it depends on any given day. They didn't all come at the same time, you know.
And remind people who these kids are.
These are kids who are infected or affected by HIV and AIDS. Mm-hmm. And I must say that it was a voluntary program, and these kids came. Mm-hmm. My favorite story was 2 or 3 years into the program. The program has been around for 13 years. Mm-hmm. It was raining one afternoon, and I said, oh, I'll go anyways. I'll pass by. I don't think anybody's going to come because it's raining. Dwight, they came in the rain.
Wow.
And that's when I realized how important it was for these kids, because it was a safe space for them. Okay, many of them hold the secret of their positive status and don't share it with anybody because they're afraid of stigma and discrimination, mm-hmm. which unfortunately is still a reality in our society.
Yeah.
And so they came in the rain, and that made me realize how important the program was. Also, we fed them. That was key. They got a snack after school, and then they got a hot meal before they went home. And I think parents also realized how important that was for them to have that meal, and so parents encouraged them to come as well, too.
What are the age ranges that we're talking about here?
Zero to the kids themselves, I would say from zero to about 20. Wow. And then as the kids got older, we still worked with them because, you know, there were still challenges and issues. And then, of course, their families became a part of the program as well, too. So, for example, with our grocery delivery that we started after the pandemic, you can't just take food in for one child. You have to take food in for the whole family.
Yeah.
So they, you know, zero up to whatever.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking after them all, providing them with support. And our social worker, they have access. Mm-hmm. They have access to psychological counseling. The social worker helps them if they can't get to clinic, to help them make sure they get to clinic. If they're in hospital, she's there for them. If they're having trouble getting their medication, she's there doing that. So we're still trying to do all of that, as well as go out to the family islands. We were going out to the family islands before the pandemic, and then we had to stop that, and we've started it again. And our goal is to tap 5 family islands every year. So we've done 4 so far. We've got 1 more to go.
Wow.
And next year we will continue the same thing. And the people on the family islands really appreciate you coming out because they often don't see a lot of people, you know, so they are pleased to have you come out and talk to them and share with them about HIV and AIDS. And when we go out, we work with the younger kids, with the adolescents, and with the adults. We have a team of people led by Dr. Carlene Smith-McKenzie, who is a member of our board and just an incredible health educator. So all those kinds of programs need to continue to run, and so the ball is key to be able to operate those programs. And just HIV/AIDS education and awareness generally in the community for everyone, including key populations, is also important.
Do you think you'll get back to the number of staff that you had? Are you able to do that maybe with the ball?
With your money.
Support, yeah.
With your ticket purchases.
Right.
Wow.
So before we get to the ball again, the stigma, the attitudes we have about HIV and AIDS,
yes.
What are we seeing now?
It's still there.
Mm-hmm.
It's still there. And the best gauge of that is that people who are themselves positive are not telling other people. They're not standing up in public and saying, I'm HIV positive. So we don't really have a face of you know, HIV in the Bahamas. And so people think that, oh, it's not with us anymore. And yeah. then, of course, when COVID came along, we were all consumed by COVID and HIV AIDS was pushed in the background. Mm-hmm. So people think that, oh, I don't know anybody who's positive, but they probably do.
Right.
But that person's not going to tell them. Patients don't even want to tell their relatives mm-hmm. that they're HIV positive. So that stigma, unfortunately, is still there.
Yeah.
And so that's something that we have to work. And education is the key. That's what right. that's what's necessary. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. My goodness. All right. So, Laverne.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Dwight. I was just going to say, you know, you see public figures who have been able to manage this disease, who've been able and who's still here, right?
Yes.
You would think that when you see that, it's an opportunity to be able to say, I don't have to live quietly with this or be ashamed, you know, I have it, but I can still live.
Right. I mean, I taught for a zillion years at University of the Bahamas. And
including me.
Yes, that's right. That's right. I was one of my former students. And students will always say, well, look at Magic Johnson. Certainly there's a cure. Look at him.
Right.
He has the money to have those things to support him. And the persons that we work with don't have that. You know, we work with persons who are of low income. They don't have all of that to sustain them, make them look like a Magic Johnson. Right.
Wow. So. Yeah. All right. So, again, how important is the Red Ribbon Ball to
Super
the AIDS Foundation?
Yes. So, the Red Ribbon Ball is our major fundraiser, and it is the catalyst of the funds that we need to carry on our very important work that Lady Barnett spoke about for the Bahamas AIDS Foundation. And this year, on November 4th at Atlantis Grand Ballroom, we will be hosting our Red Ribbon Ball. We have not been able to have the ball for 3 years for obvious reasons, but we begin cocktails at 7 p.m. The ball begins promptly at 8. We won't wait for you getting your makeup done if, you know, be there on time.
What number is this now? This is
27th.
This is the 27th annual Red wow. Ribbon Ball. Mm-hmm. And this year, our theme is 1001 Arabian Nights. Mm-hmm. So think all things Middle Eastern, Moroccan. The room is going to be beautifully decorated by wildflowers. We have Zaymar helping us, you know, with the sound and lighting. Commonwealth Brewery is going to be in the house with wines. So we're going to have wines from Santa Margherita. And the grand prize winner will be whisked off to Italy to the Santa Margherita Vineyard.
Say that again now.
Our grand prize winner will be whisked off to Italy. We're going to serve Santa Margherita wines, and the grand prize for the ball, that lucky person will go to Italy. They will stay at the chateau. This is an experience you cannot pay for.
My
you must
goodness.
Be you must yeah. be invited, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is what we're putting on. John Bull is going to be in the house with luxury prizes. In fact, when you go to Italy, John Bull is going to give you luggage, right? So we don't need that luggage with the duct tape. John Bull got you straight with some really nice luggage. John Bull has a luxury package we're going to have as a prize for the ball. We have raffle prize, a survival package. The survival package got gas, water and sewage, BPL.
I was going to say BPL.
That's the survival package. We got a pamper package, which is a full body everything, facial, manicure, pedicure, hotel package. Uh-huh. We have a private party package. That's going to be Playhouse DJs, Marv Cunningham, okay. Mr. Mix, and of course, Commonwealth Brewery will come in with the beverages, the wine tour, like I mentioned. It's just going to be a spectacular time. We have Alan Wallace will be painting a live painting that we're going to auction off. So we want you to come and open your hearts, open your wallets. Mm-hmm. We're going to be there with the credit card machine. So if you don't get a time, you know, to stop by the ATM to get there on time, that's fine. We got you. We got credit card machines there for you. And we just want people to really, really come and support. We are encouraging the corporate Bahamas to really support us with buying tables. You can give us a call at 808-9152. And, you know, we will come and deliver the tickets to you.
Excellent.
And collect your check, or you could give us a wire deposit.
Yes,
or absolutely. Blank check. How about that? How much are the tickets? How much are the tickets?
So donations for the ball is only $300 per ticket. So that's $3,000 a table. But we also have other packages, platinum tables, gold tables, silver tables. And our platinum table, help me out, Lady Barnett, is $6,000
for the platinum.
$6,000.
Yeah. And what do you get with that?
You get to give us a little bit more money. And actually, we have a little bit more. There's more there's more stuff going on at the table.
Mm-hmm. Amenities.
Amenities, yes. Thank you so much, Laverne. And those tables will be closer to the dance floor.
Mm. That's the prime
and
spot
you get
right,
to
the dance floor.
You get to feel better about your life. Sleep at night better. Closer to Jesus. Wow. You know, closer to heaven. It's just all of that.
All right, so I want to talk more about the theme. This is a really fun theme.
1001 Arabian Nights.
All right, so should people come dressed
in
that theme too?
Absolutely, if you want to.
Yeah.
But, you know, you wear what you want to wear. Mm. There are some people who are planning on wearing, you know, this Moroccan-looking Middle Eastern type thing. Mm-hmm. I've had people say, girl, I have all my belly out for the Ralph Lauren today or whatever, right? But there will be special points of interest in the room. Wildflowers has gone all out to decorate this room, and we've seen mock-ups. It's going to be mind-blowing, right?
Yes.
There'll be special points of interest all around the room that will really speak to this Middle Eastern theme, and there's going to be featured Middle Eastern entertainment section that you do not want to miss. I mean, we have Killer Bee as our DJ. We have Essence Band at the cocktail reception. And Falcon will be our house band. The Red Ribbon Ball is a party ball. This is a party ball disguised as a stuffy, opulent event.
Yeah, it always
so
has
you dress
been.
Up. You dress up really fancy. And then you leave with your shoes in your hand, your makeup dripping, and you know your tie loose. It's a
the fancy
party.
Hairstyle is all ruined.
Last week we had a tasting at Atlantis, and they laid out
fabulous,
everything.
Fabulous.
Listen to me, everything from the minute you leave ballet to the moment you return to your car, you will be engaged and you will be blown away.
All right, so that was going to be the next question because you know some people come for the food.
Nobody at the Red Ribbon Ball
expect with that.
So
it was fabulous. It was absolutely a fabulous tasting.
Yeah.
We have lobster. We have the most tender beef. It was just divine. Mm. The most delicious soup. It was a corn and some kind of a seafood chowder with corn. It was delicious.
The dessert
absolutely.
Is to die for.
Oh,
there will be points of interest, you know, just really with the Middle Eastern team.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be... The Red Ribbon Ball will engage you. Of course, it's our major fundraiser. Mm-hmm. Some people consider it to be an expensive venture, but it is worth every dime. Mm-hmm. Most of you are walking around with tennis shoes that cost more than my mortgage. Please, just for this one night, come out and support. The work is very, very important. Mm-hmm. I can't get away from that. But this is a night to really have fun and celebrate those that have survived this disease. And to really commemorate those that have lost the fight.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so let people know again how to get tickets.
Okay, you can get tickets by calling us at 808-9152, November 4th, Atlantis Grand Ballroom, 7 p.m., 1001 Arabian Nights.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be a great time.
It's going to be a very good time.
I just want to say that, you know, people are wondering, why 1001 Arabian Nights? What's the connection to HIV and AIDS? Well, the 1001 Arabian Nights are stories. And they're stories about resistance and courage and perseverance and love.
Survival.
Exactly.
Wow.
And that's the connection.
Okay.
That's the connection.
Very interesting. Looking forward to it. It's going to be great. Thank you all so much. Keep up the wonderful work that you're doing at the Bob's AIDS Foundation.
Thank you for having
Always
us.
Great talking to you both. Ron, thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Great. Thank you too, Dwight.
Bye-bye.
We're going to take a break for news and then be back with business. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Is gone. Let's not kill the karma. Let's not start.
This
is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, today. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Tuesday, October 17th, 2023. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strachan along with Laverne Gardner. And this morning we are talking with the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. World Standards Day was just this past Saturday, October 14th. And we're very pleased to have back with us, it's been a while, Executive Director Dr. Renee Ferguson Bufford. And Marketing Officer Tyra Folks as well. Good morning, ladies. Great to have you with us.
Good morning, Dwight. Good morning, thanks for Dwight. Having us.
So happy belated World Standards Day.
Yes. Thank you.
All right, so before we get into the work of the Bureau, tell us about World Standards Day. And there was a special theme this year. And what we're hoping to accomplish with something like World Standards Day.
Well, I think, first of all, we have to go into what standards are. Big standards is a document that outlines quality assurance. Mm-hmm. So that goes for anything. We our role basically coincides with anything that you could think of. Right now it's water,
products,
services, processes, mm-hmm. all of that. So World Standards Day, it's a global event. It really emphasizes the importance of international standards as well. So it was in partnership with the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, IEC, which is the International Electrotechnical Commission, and ITU, International Telecommunications Union. Sorry. So the theme this year was a shared vision for a better world. So it really enforced the critical role of international standards in shaping a brighter future. We highlighted the SDG3, the Sustainable Development Goal under the United Nations, which was ensuring healthy lives and well-being for all, irrespective of ages. So our goal really is to ensure quality assurance in healthcare this year. So that was our focus for World Standards Day this year. So that's what we're celebrating. And then we're hoping that we could work and partner with the Ministry of Health to accomplish these goals as well.
Okay, so tell us more about that. What type of standards in healthcare are we focusing on?
Okay, so we have international standards in healthcare. Right now, what we're looking at is ISO 9000. I'm sorry, the names could kind of get a little crazy. Mm-hmm. So like I said before, ISO is International Organization for Standardization. So the names kind of go with that. So ISO 9001, which is the quality management systems, that basically is the overarching framework for implementing a quality manager. So it enhances organizational efficiency and customer satisfaction. And you know that is really needed in the Bahamas,
very
especially
much so.
In healthcare. You know, we have a lot of complaints within healthcare. So something like that, a standard like that could really help to push customer satisfaction over the edge, especially in the hospitals and in the clinics. So we know that the government is moving towards creating a healthy Bahamas and creating better infrastructure for us in healthcare. So that, along with standards and quality assurance, it really, hand in hand, it boosts healthcare even more.
So tell us more about that, because many people will say, well, clearly we don't have any standards here, which is not the case. But how do you improve the standard, especially if you're busy doing the day-to-day work in the hospital? Where do you all come in with that, and how do you get to the next level?
So
Okay. Dr. Buffett?
Our mm-hmm. job is to promote standardization, mm-hmm. promote processes and practices mm-hmm. At that national level. So we hope that the market is market-driven, mm-hmm. and so our job is to help to foster or push the market, propel the market, even to come to us if necessary. Mm-hmm. But we encourage you to come to us and bring the justification for the reason
the
why.
Public?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's market-driven. It's,
right.
it's industry-driven. And so on these types of days, we do try to push the envelope, especially with given the theme, we then encourage it at the industry level.
Right.
So in terms of healthcare and our hospitals, we want to push and promote certain conformity assessment standards. Right now, currently, I will tell you, we do have some conformity that involves testing, laboratories and stuff in the healthcare. And I would tell you that the Princess Margaret Hospital, they do have accreditation.
Mm.
They are accredited, their laboratories are accredited.
Mm-hmm.
And so we would like to say that from the beginning.
Okay.
So you, and even their AIDS lab, they are accredited as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to push this quality management system 9001 because we know we talk a lot about the operations of the hospital. There are a lot of complaints, you know, from almost all of us, the emergency systems, et cetera. And so having a broader scope and dealing with the management system and the operations, streamlining their efficiencies, reducing the errors, delivering more efficiency and patient-centric care. That is the standard that we would like to push with them. And I think the patients will benefit, including the doctors in the hospital, the nurses, et cetera, all of the operational managers, if everybody gets together and do this as the team effort
mm-hmm.
of the organization, all of the leaders there. I think that will encourage better services, operations, you know, like I said, reduce errors and efficiency. And there's a win-win for all. And it pushes over into us as the patients that are coming into
right.
the hospital. So we do want to partner with the minister and his team. And look at some of the others. There is an ISO 20,000 set of standards, healthcare organizational management requirements for patient-centered staffing. So we would like to look at that. And then there is also the 45,000 suite occupational health and safety management systems. So there are a lot of conformity assessment standards that do exist at the ISB, like I said, the organization for standardization, and they are the world leaders in the development of standards. And so you have a whole lot of health informatics, sterilization of healthcare products, sterilization, biological indicators, chemical indicators, and we do know that they do have medical laboratories. They are already certified, like I said, accredited to those type of standards.
Mm.
Yeah.
All right, so that's the public hospitals.
I wanted to ask, good morning, ladies. Do you find that the hospital healthcare in general, they're open maybe to, or are you in a position where you can make recommendations to say, you know, maybe can we look at tweaking this, or if you tweak that, perhaps you get better results in terms of standards and quality assurance? Do you have that kind of relationship where you can look at maybe a system that's already in place?
Yes.
And offer recommendations or suggestions based on global standards or world standards according to your organization?
Oh, yeah, most definitely. And it's interesting that you mentioned that, talking about recommendations. So Minister Davil, their team has been very open in receiving the information. And, of course, we know, like I said, they have the mantle that they're going by, a healthy Bahamas. So, like I said, it works hand in hand with the infrastructure, and we are meeting with them to sit mm-hmm. down and recommend this. So it's something that we could look forward to. I know a lot of people don't like to hear that these things take time, but especially with the quality management system, it takes
mm-hmm.
time. It's not something that we could go in and tomorrow there's mm-hmm. something. So it's an overall improvement of the entire system. So that's something that we could definitely look forward to. And it's interesting to all of it that the ISO 9001, it's not just for the hospital. Like I said, it's a quality management system. So it's something that any business can adopt. So
any business.
Right. So it streamlines.
Is not just the public hospitals or are the clinics, a lot of the private
of
entities that are opening up, they have to meet these standards as well.
Yes.
All right. All right. So.
To answer her question, we have been working with the Ministry of Health for a very long time now. And one of their very top persons would have been sat on the Bureau's board for a very long time. And so we work in conjunction with them, and we do a lot of stuff. When we opened for COVID, we were there with them. We actually had a webinar, a guideline for opening up the healthcare systems and the country. And so we were instrumental in working with the Ministry of Health and their health and wellness unit. And a consensus was received by the country, all of the stakeholders, et cetera.
Excellent.
We work with them as well with other standards now that we're developing. And one of those standards would be the, and we have our standards officer here now. We talked about the beauty and wellness unit. So we could look forward to some regulations regarding all of the beauty industry, the barber shops, the hairstyle shops, the nail salons, et cetera, and receiving some regulations even where that is concerned.
Okay. All right. So, these are some of the things we want to talk about. Tamara Baker is joining us now, standards officer. As earlier we mentioned food and water. And let's talk about this. All these things that come under your scope. Are people complying? Are people adhering to this? How difficult is it to get folks to meet these standards? Tamara, you want to take that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Let's get your mic
Good
up there.
Good morning, everyone.
All right. Hi.
So I think the beauty community is very excited about it. Those that have been involved in the technical committee have really been working arduously at creating these standards. So we're looking at just a general code of practice for beauty and wellness, also hygienic practice for the spas, hygienic practice for tattoo parlors, hygienic practice for the hairdressers and the barbershops. Mm-hmm. So they're looking for it.
Yeah, they're the ones who brought it to us.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
So, because like I said, it's market driven.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So they're very excited and to answer that question. But stakeholders, we have the stakeholders that are coming all the time to us. And here she is our team lead, the head for standards department. And we do have compliance at a certain level, of course, but the sensitization to get the word out there and an informed consumer, you know, the more we get it out, will more than likely, most times, abide.
So are you all doing the testing? Like, as you mentioned, water, food, do you go around and make sure that even though they have been pushing for these things, that they do meet the requirements?
Well,
let's pull that back a little bit closer to your feet. There we go. Okay.
Well, we create the standards, and then the regulators police the standards. So we work hand in hand to get it done.
Who would be the regulators?
So the various public service sectors. So, for instance, environmental health, where the water standards, the bottled water standards are concerned. We have specifications to water, and so every water bottler in the country should be abiding by the national standard that was adopted at the regional and international level. And then the Ministry of the Environment, Department of Environment and Health, they have those standards and they do the job of policing those standards. So maybe not all of the standard that, you know, all the regulations would be enforced, but for the most part, the ones that they feel would impact the health and safety of our consumers, which would be ourselves, they are going to police that.
Yeah.
We also have the standard for code of hygienic practice. So we're looking at not at just the bottling of the standard, but the whole hygiene of the business itself, the labs, et cetera. So they do police that as well. And yes, they do give citations and they do shut down those that are not abiding mm-hmm. by it.
Is this happening on the family islands as well?
Yes, it is. Okay. Yes. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, we're archipelago. We know that, and it is a challenge. And so I can't speak for environmental health, but I do know that it is a challenge sometimes to get those inspectors on those family checks that are needed.
Yeah. Yeah. Are there any sectors that you haven't been able to get to as yet that's on the drawing board that you hope that you will be able
sectors.
To? Oh, boy. Okay. Want to hear about this.
Yes. I mean, mm-hmm. so, you know, we are not even 10 years old, mm-hmm. and we do need many more standard officers, many more technical officers. So this is a cry for that as well. And then we do have another act. And so our Weights and Measures Act. I think we came in here several times to talk about the metrology. We're turning it into the common term, which is metrology. Mm-hmm. It's the science of measurement. And so that act is our enforcement act. And we look at the regulations of all weights and measurement activities in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. And that within itself is a Herculean task as well, because it involves measurements.
Mm-hmm. And then if I could add, just like Dr. Buffett said, we're still fairly new. So mm-hmm. it's really, like she said, sensitization, mm-hmm. Trying to get the Bahamian people to understand the importance of standards, the importance of what we do here at the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. So when you pick up a bottle of water, do you know the process that goes through it? Mm. Do you know that the safety measures that go through it? Are you just, you know, I mean, many times we're not even concerned about that, but there's a lot that goes into it as well. Like Dr. Buffett said, with metrology, when you go to the pump, are you sure that you're getting what you pay for? So that's our goal. That's our mandate. When you go to the pump, when you go shopping at the grocery store, there are stickers that we have that says approve or reject it mm-hmm. to those pumps or those scales. Mm-hmm. So you have to look out for those to make sure that you are actually getting what you pay for.
Yeah. I mean, I've been curious about it. Maybe it's something wrong with me, but I mean, there are lots of people making drinks these days. You know, are they doing this in their bathtub? Are they just pouring sugar? How do you know?
That's a Herculean task, right. Dwight. Mm-hmm. You're putting on us. But it's not our responsibility to police. Our responsibility is to actually help promote proper quality assurances and quality care in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have the actual word quality on the end of our name, because we are trying to push and promote quality, quality, quality. So if you see something going on and if you think there is a need to develop some standardization at that national level, and then if it's going to impact, as our mandate tells us to do, to promote that healthy living in the country and the safety, then we need to then take it to the next level and put some technical regulation, some mandate on it.
And also it is a call to entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. anyone who's making any type of food, any products. Mm-hmm. It is a call to you guys. So you could reach out to the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. We may have a standard that you can adopt.
I am sure there is a standard.
Right.
I'm sure there is a standard.
Might I add, we're really trying to promote a quality culture.
Mm-hmm.
So if everyone has that mindset, then we can all work together to bring it about.
Right. So I know from the last time you're here to look out for, if you're at the gas pump, look out for stickers there.
Yes.
But is there something equivalent for food products that they're made here, whether they...
Well, talk about made here. Do we segue into that? That's a nice segue. Well, we're segueing very early into this. But that is the next priority step for us, the next phase of it's made in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
And certifications, so we're developing a certification scheme right now for any product, even processes or practices, et cetera. It could be service sector based, mm-hmm. made or produced here. We are looking to understudy and understand it very well, but we are pushing this. So the minister will be coming and our board mm-hmm. to talk about, to promote.
Which minister is that?
Minister. We fall under the Ministry of Economic Affairs.
Okay, all right.
Minister, mm-hmm. Senator, the Honorable Michael Halkitas. Mm-hmm. So
that's coming.
That is coming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. So product services, they could look out to have that made in the Bahamas seal, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a quality mark.
And so you'll know this has met all the standards. All the labels on this are accurate.
Accurate.
Some people are saying their products don't have any calories. And like, are you sure? I don't know about that.
Yes. It'll be distinct. So you, so nobody could come and just put made in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. So it'll be distinct. So consumers could recognize it.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. And it's very good to promote our products abroad. So I think you look at the importation and exportation of products. So now we get to be able to give that stamp, that seal, that it is actually made here. So I am sure the Bahamians would look forward to having that distinct seal on their products so they can take it to the next level.
Excellent. So we have some questions coming in, and you can ask your questions as well. Text us 422-4796, and you don't mind if we take any calls, right? It'll be fine, right? 323-6232-325-4316. 325-4259. You can call us toll free, 242-300-5720. We're talking with the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality. All right, so this texter is saying, my husband and I were watching an American commentary on FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, and the USDA just yesterday. I found myself saying that we need something like this to be more active in our country, especially in the area of imported foods that are and those that are being sold as export only. That comes up a lot.
You know, that comes up all the time, yes. So that doesn't necessarily mean that it's substandard product. Mm-hmm. It just means that they can have bulk products, and it has to do with taxation. And so many times they just send it someplace else. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it is a substandard product.
Right.
But that's the importance of the Bureau of Standards as well, mm-hmm. and the importance of us with the joint effort of other stakeholders, industries working together to ensure that even the food labels, we do have a standard for food labels, by the way. Mm-hmm. Yes, and so... But Dwight, I would like to say we cannot work in silos. Mm-hmm. We have to work with every industry, the key players in the country. And it's very important that I echo that right here, is that we are welcomed. We welcome you to come to us. And that's why sensitization is so important. And bring these key elements up, and let's collaborate together, because we our standards office work with you in the development and the adoption, because we don't have to, nothing have to be reinvented. There is enough stuff around that we can just, work together. There are enough standards out there, hundreds and thousands of standards that we can adopt at the international level. It works for us because we're leveling the playing field, and it helps us to promote the exportation of our goods and services.
When you talk about metrology, I know it's been an issue in the past, some people using scales in supermarkets and the scale not being accurate.
Yes.
Has that improved? And what do you do if you suspect that this scale is not working properly?
I'm glad. I feel like I'm talking a lot, but I guess I am the administrator here. But we're talking about metrology. Today is standards day, but let's talk about the scales. So we do have an issue, more so with the scales, and more so at that local, that market level, the mom and pop shops. There are a lot of them that are in conformance and compliance, but we do have some issues with some of the scales not being in it. Furthermore, we do have some issues, and this more is a policy thing, so I would love for the minister to probably promote this more than myself, but we do have some of those markets not always willing to allow us in.
Oh.
Or they don't, yes. So we do have, not a lot of them, but we're getting there.
Is that against the law, or does it
need to be? It's against the law. It's a Weight and Measures Act. Our job is to regulate. Mm-hmm. All weights and measurement activities.
So what do you do when you're refused entry?
Well, we write, we draw it to the attention of the minister and the board, and usually we'll have to have law enforcement come and assist us with that, because our job is to, we're inspectors just like a custom officer, we have a license to be able to come in and enter any property at any time.
Wow. Okay.
And inspect.
And you said it's not metrology we're talking about here, but
that's fine.
With gasoline. I had an issue a few months ago where I could see the fuel dripping while I was getting the car pumped. I'm like, wait a minute now. I'm clearly not getting all of this fuel.
Oh, boy.
And the response from the manager was, not acceptable. But those things are happening. What do you do when you encounter a situation like that? What should you do?
Well, I wish my charge inspectors were here because they do. So most of the, so we have the three main service providers. We have the Sun Oil, Soil, and Rubes.
Right.
So they have their own inspectors. And those persons normally are not far away. So our inspectors go out. So for the pumps, we go out twice a year. For the scales, because there's a mass amount, we have thousands and thousands of them. We do that on an annual basis. Mm-hmm. And as I said, this is a push and a call for more technical officers in that field. You have to have a degree in sciences. I should mention that. Mm-hmm. But if there isn't problem, if there is an issue, you can certainly bring it to our attention. And we will send our inspectors out to inspect those pumps to just make sure everything is flowing and going as it should be. And there are the quality assurances around those proper measurements are being taken. We will put a seal on it. We will cap it. If it's not in conformance, there is a cap that goes on that is sealed, and they should not be using it until they bring the pump back up to par. All right, have their technical officers. Now, if you see where a seal is broken or a sticker is not on a pump and it doesn't say that they've met the compliance to say approved, then you should call us.
Okay.
Right. So it either approved sticker or a denied sticker. And there should be some red thing on it that should show you that. I will say that even at the airports, and I'm not calling anybody out, but lately we have been traveling and we have seen some of those huge scales, and our stickers have been removed.
Oh, so, wow. For luggage? Yeah, that's what you mean?
Absolutely. Everything that involves the weights and measurement.
So what are you saying? The scales might not be accurate.
Well, like I said, I am
so this
just,
is why it's important that we're
very
here.
Important to sensitize.
Because yeah. they're charging
say.
People extra.
We're not getting into
all the time.
No, so Dwight, remember we came on your show before because there was some sensationalization that went on when we did. I had to present at an energy forum. What we said was we found that 50%. Do you remember that it was in your in the Guardian? The 50% were in compliance.
Right.
And so it went out like that you all are not being charged. It could be the opposite as well. So it could be, So we want you to know that it goes, but we are here for both the consumer, the producer, the end user, everyone. So just know that they also have to get from someplace else as well.
So keep that in mind.
So we just, our job is to equalize and to be that the person in the middle, not to, we're not taking sides here in any kind of way. We're promoting a quality culture, quality across the scale, across the board.
All right. So this might be a standard issue, and it's a personal pet peeve of mine, but the service stations here do not tell you the octane level. And does it come before you all? You should know this, but you can't get a straight answer, and they don't display this.
To have my metrology engineers here with me. I will say that while we're talking about metrology, we are starting a new service. The minister has made, and it's industrial metrology. And so that's the calibration of all the stuff that you're talking about now. And we are producing those labs, at least the first lab, which is mass metrology. I would like to promote that, I guess, because we're talking about metrology here. We'll have to come back, Dwight, and talk more and more about metrology.
Because
I see you're pushing the envelope far off. We're supposed to be dealing with standards today. So I would love for them to come on and have this conversation. So maybe we can invite them here.
This texture says you need to come and check the scale at my doctor's office because there's no way that's accurate.
I'm sure we all feel that way, and me too as well. I always complain. Keep in mind that it's not just scale. So we're talking about blood pressure machines. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the pipettes, volumetric. I mean, metrology is like I said, Herculean. So we have pressure, We have the volumetric stuff. We have dimensional analysis. I can go on. We're talking about concrete testing, the blocks. So I know if we get into metrology, that will throw us far off today.
Do a special 2-hour show on that one.
Yes.
All right. So you recently won a seat. You're going to blush now, right? On the International Organization for Standardization. Tell us about that and what this means.
Well, I think it's a historic thing for us in the Bahamas. This is the first time that the Bahamas would be sitting at the highest level of the International Organization for Standardization, ISO. So most industry players, ISO is. They are the world leaders, the global leaders in standards development. Mm-hmm. And so this is significant for us because I think if there was a seat, there may have been a seat in the CARICOM countries many, many years ago.
Right.
So it's 70-something years old. And if we've had a seat there at the CARICOM level, we're not sure of that. We believe that we were the first ones. And so it's significant for the entire Caribbean.
Mm-hmm.
So having a seat gives us a voice. You know, we want to promote our national agenda, mm-hmm. Blueprint for Change. We're looking at climate change right now, climate resilience, digitization, and artificial intelligence, trade. Mm. We're for food management systems. We're talking about healthcare. So this allows us that level of being able to hear our voices being heard at this global stage.
Right.
So there are 20 countries. All of the main key players like the United States, we have like Germany, Spain, France, Japan. I think those are some of the big players that actually sit at that table always.
Mm-hmm.
So developing states have never sat at the table.
Excellent. Wow.
So we made history in September Assembly, General Assembly, where, of course, we went and did our campaign. So let me say, we can't nominate ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we had 8 countries that nominated us, mm-hmm. and it started with Canada and Brazil and Argentina and some of the Caribbean islands. And we wanted to promote, they're trying to promote a little bit of gender balance as well, because it's always been, there are 20 seats, and mm-hmm. it's very male-dominated.
Wow.
So we had the opportunity, and we did some campaigning, and so many persons didn't think that this would happen. They were like, oh, they're not going to, you know, because they see us as a little dot.
Mm.
They really do. They mm-hmm. really don't think that we have the capacity, the economic development, the sustainability, you know, to really bring anything to the table. And we're a service sector. And so they were like, oh, you know, our Caribbean island, small island developing states, and mm-hmm. We made history because we received the highest votes
at the highest vote.
There were nine or 12 countries in different groups. And out of all of the countries, the Bahamas received the highest votes. Yeah. So
excellent. All right. So to the people, many, I hear this all the time. People say anything goes, anything buck up and go in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. That's clearly not the case. What are you doing to fight that perception that you could just do whatever you want, you're beholden to nobody?
Well, and once again, I guess I'm talking here. We can have our marketing officer talk, but Dwight, that's the reason why we're here.
Mm-hmm.
So getting out there, getting our voices heard, trying to promote standardization, because it all starts there. It's the foundation mm-hmm. of everything. And to the microphones that we're talking in right now, to the headphones we have on, clothes on our backs, they all involve some type of standard. So we have got to get out and do as much promotion, much awareness. And I would say it starts even at the highest level of government and them promoting standards. We talk standards.
Right.
We need to walk standards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so mm-hmm. like Dr. Buffett said, sure. It starts from the top all the way to the bottom. And it's also a personal thing as well.
Mm-hmm.
Even like when we said when persons don't want to pick up trash or anything like that, that starts within. It starts with Bahamians wanting a culture of quality.
Right.
So we all have to get involved. It's something that we, all of our hands are in. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we need to promote.
Mm-hmm. I just want to add, tomorrow? Just awareness adding too. To what Ms. Folks just said, it's about taking ownership.
Mm-hmm.
It's about taking ownership. We want our things to work, drive, you know, into our computer. We want it to work. Mm-hmm. So that's standards. So if you want to see things work, you should also be on the other end where you want to participate in the process. And you wouldn't want to have a everything goes, anything buck up goes
right.
mentality.
Right, yeah. Right. And you've mentioned it a couple of times, Dr. Bufford, that you need more people in this sector.
Yes.
Let's talk about that and what field you need to specialize in and how many more people you need to really do all the things you need to do there at the Bureau.
Let's talk money. Let's talk about get the minister and the government to push the envelope and the agenda a little bit, mm-hmm. and to give us more money to move this double agenda we have, because we do have two mandates. But we are looking for science majors. We need administrators as well, but we do need technical officers in the degrees of the natural or the physical sciences. Mm-hmm. So physical means you have a degree in math or physics for the engineering area, which is very difficult here, I know, because I'm not sure at the university level if we do. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe, but even in the natural sciences, standards officers most of the times have degrees in the technical area. Mm-hmm. But if they have some science and it is a degree that's close enough to the scientific area, we can look at it and see. And then, you know, they'd be able to talk, mm-hmm. train, because they do a lot of technical committee meetings. They have some type of management skill, interact with others, and then manage the technical committees.
Right.
And we're willing to hear, bring them in and have the interview and talk to them and see how that goes.
Mm-hmm. What's your staff?
We have 24 now there at the Bureau.
It's pretty small.
Yes, yes.
And how many do you think you need to do all the things you need to do?
Oh, wow. So I can tell you, Jamaica is much bigger than we are, but Jamaica has probably 200-300 staff members, and Trinidad has the same. Mm-hmm. I think Trinidad has 160 inspectors. Wow. But the difference with them is, you know, they're basically on one island. I mean, Jamaica has some ports out there. But so we have to have persons eventually stationed, mm-hmm. Probably centrally and on the southern islands eventually. Mm-hmm. But it calls for a lot of work and it calls for a lot of equipment. So I know that we're not even thinking about that part of it. And every year, annually, we are supposed to ensure that those equipments are calibrated.
Right.
So a lot of money goes into ensuring quality, and it should be. Because
mm-hmm.
it's a trust thing. You have to, and like I said, it goes both ways. Confidence in what we do, confidence in what you're purchasing, and the trade market is very important. Mm-hmm. And so it goes for the consumer and the producer and the middleman.
We're talking with Dr. Renee Ferguson-Bufford, Tamara Baker, and Tyra Folks. Only a couple minutes left, but what is in the near future for the Bureau and long-term, what can we expect?
Okay. Well, go ahead. Okay. Tyra? I mentioned the ISO 9001 quality management systems. Persons could look for it in December, possibly in December, that we're having a training workshop. So mm-hmm. like I said, businesses, it's not just for hospitals, healthcare, businesses, it helps to streamline operations. Like Dr. Buffett said, reduce errors, deliver more efficiency. So businesses can reach us, training workshop as well, and we're also offering other accreditations as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So in December, the 6th, I believe, we're scheduling it until the 12th. We're having an accreditation workshop at the full week, 5 days. So we're looking to do a training certification to 9001 quality management systems. We're also looking to do trainings with the accreditation 17065. And then that's the labs of products and services accreditation, and then we also have a 15,000. You have the
15189 for the medical laboratories.
Okay. Yes.
So all persons, stakeholders that are interested in being certified or perhaps to receive accreditation training, they can certainly reach out to the Bureau, and you want to give them the information, Baker?
Let me add, it'll be mm-hmm. good for businesses who want to attend. It's also good because you could show off that accreditation. You could show that Absolutely. You have this accreditation.
Right.
now that we're, once they have this accreditation, it actually means something. Mm-hmm. So it shows that quality assurance.
Yeah, so they can email us at bbsqstandards@gmail.com, or they can email us at standards@bbsq.bs.
Okay. All right. And when can we expect the Made in Bahamas, that initiative, to move forward?
Yes. So like I said, I'll reiterate that. Made in the Bahamas certification scheme, our aim is to enhance the quality and recognition of Bahamian products, processes, practices, services into the global market, or even in the global market, and is a substantial step in supporting local entrepreneurs and businesses, providing them with a competitive edge by certifying the origin and quality of their products and services. And our intention is to begin that in 2024.
Okay, excellent. Let's take this call really quickly. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Mr. Strong. And good Hi. Morning to your guest. I hope I'm still young enough. But Dwight, yeah, you know, I was listening to the conversation and I was in and out, but this is a quality and standards bureau as it relates to just like medical for supplies, drugs, et cetera, or it's basically generalized, because it's I've been noticing a lot of things, and you know, to the superconscious mind, this, they have a tumultuous task going on as far as toxicity levels in all products, and even inferiority as it relates to, like, for instance, the fluorescent bulbs. You know, for some reason, I have noticed, you know, I'm 59 years old, I have noticed that they only last like a month or two, even some of the LED bulbs. So I'm wondering, like, what is it with this? They don't last. They used to, I never used to have to replace them like that, Dwight. Like, I have the receipts. Maybe after a month, they turn black. And then as far as the chemical constituents of solar panels and fluorescent bulbs, the chemicals like phosphor and mercury, what I'm saying is, even as it relates to the vaccines and some food products, and as it relates to water constituents as far as potable water guidelines, can I ask what are some of the toxins that you have found in the drinking water as far as cadmium, nickel, lead? But because we have anthropogenic activity here just like anywhere else. So what I'm saying is, how does this benefit the public as far as making the public aware, instead of all of us being guinea pigs and having blind trust in products that we use and also that we consume? So this is a tumultuous task for somebody like me who's listening here with nothing more than just O-level chemistry and dropped out of A-level chemistry. But what I'm saying is, this is a tumultuous task, Dr. Saad. And so as far as that, even with the amalgams that dentists use, we don't know. Do you have any data on anything? Like, you know what I mean? Because you have UB right there. And it's frightening for me, even as we import stuff. And when you look at the chemical ingredients like phthalates that they use in shower curtains and lining of cans with the bisphenol A, the studies are out there on bisphenol A and B and the plastics, et cetera, but, and the grades of plastic, but yet still, we're still consuming, and it's like nobody has any power to get the manufacturers to curtail these using plastics when they know bottles are safer. And it's just like humanity is fighting a losing battle as far as the toxins coming into our body.
Let's get them to respond. Blaming us for that's getting a lot. They're running out of time.
That's a lot.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's paralyzing.
Yes, that was a lot.
Concerns.
I was
there.
Trying to write a little bit here, but concerning the bulbs and a lot of the panels that he was talking about, portable water, the standards work is driven by the market. And our job is to do as much as we can in the promotion of our mandates. We have two mandates, like I said, the Standards Act and the Weights and Measures Act. And we need to do more. We need to get out more. And we need more staff to be able to do that. And so we have to reach you all. We do have infomercials. They have been off the grid for a little bit, but we are coming out with new infomercials. And we need to probably do more boosting on our social media pages, but you can find Facebook, Twitter, I can't remember all of them, LinkedIn, et cetera, Instagram. We are there. And you can call us at 362-1748-55, 362-1748-55. And to answer that question, there is a standard for almost anything that you can think of. Mm-hmm. I mean, there is a standard. The clothes that we are wearing, the contact lenses that I have on in my eyes right now, the cosmetics that that we are wearing, there is a standard for the chair, for the table. And so I say to you, there is a standard for those fluorescent bulbs, for those bulbs. But we have to know the standard is driven by you, the consumers, and the market. And so if you come to us and there is some need or justification for it, once the board approves it, it comes through the administration and then it goes to the board, we can then form that technical committee if we don't have it already, and we can get to moving on it. So it's up to us to do as much promotion as we can, and then we depend on you to help us.
Right. Yes, I did want to mention that he brought up a lot of areas and active technical committees in various areas. I don't know if we mentioned them earlier, tourism, food, and we're bringing some new ones on stream. They want to look at things like geospatial, geographic standards, and also the list goes on.
Conformity environment. Assessment.
Yeah. Conformity assessment.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think it's also important to, it speaks to the importance of Dr. Buffett or the Bahamas' role on the International Standards Committee, the council. All of these things that he brought up, those are things that could be addressed. There could be other concerns from other small island development states, and those are things that we now have a seat on that council to bring up and address as well.
Yeah. Well, we've only scratched the surface of all the things we could talk about. You see, I told you it was going to go by quickly. but thank you all so much for being here again. Happy belated World Standards Day.
Thank you.
And we look forward to talking with the Bahamas Bureau of Standards and Quality again, Dr. Renee Bufford, Tamara Baker, and Tyra Folks. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And you know, Dwight, we're happy to be here. And we forgot to bring up the food, the front of package labeling. That has been
interesting one.
Yes, very, across the globe. It has been across the Caribbean. I think it's only the Caribbean, and so we didn't even talk about that.
All right, so we got to have you back to talk about that very soon.
Front of package labeling with the manufacturers, the private sector, and the public sector. Right. It's been very interesting.
Thank you again, ladies. Appreciate it. We're going to take a break and then back to wrap things up. This is Morning Glen Business on Guardian Radio 96.9.
This is our 50th Jubilee. We continue to celebrate 50 years of a small country that continues to do big things. This year at Character Day, we celebrate people who have love for country, those that protect and nurture our environment, those who are dedicated and provide care and hope, and those that continue to inspire through challenges and hard times. Help us to celebrate 50 people just like these. Until September 30th, log on to CharacterDayBahamas.org and nominate your hidden hero today as we spread the power of love.
Doctors Hospital has reimagined primary care. We have invested to improve our health system, ensuring that accessible, affordable, world-class clinical care is closer to you. We understand that your relationship with a primary care provider shapes the foundation of your overall health. Our new modern primary care facilities are where critical diagnoses and true personalized treatment begins. With locations across New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Exuma, we invite you to experience the Doctors Hospital difference. Book your next appointment at clinic.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
Earning zero interest on your savings? Little as $100. You can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
The signs are clear. It's time to pay less for your current Scotiabank. Enjoy lower interest rates and no payments up to 2 months when you switch to Scotiabank today. Plus, we'll even pay your switch costs. It's that easy. Ready to switch to Scotiabank? Call us today at 242-356-1697 or visit bs.scotiabank.com to switch your mortgage to become mortgage-free faster.
It is time for your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL. Securities Commissioner of the Bahamas Executive Director Christina Roll tells Guardian Business that while there was an initial stigma of being a jurisdiction associated with failed cryptocurrency exchange FTX, there continues to be steady interest in this jurisdiction as one with effective digital assets legislation. Roll says the interest sparked by the Digital Assets and Registered Exchanges Act has been better than any other piece of legislation. Read more in our comments in today's Guardian Business section. The Bahamas will host the Roots America's Travel Industry Conference in 2025. Roots World announcing this in a statement yesterday, saying that major announcements of new direct airlift to the Bahamas will be made at that conference. The announcement at Nassau Paradise Island Promotion Board, Nassau Airport Development Company, and the Ministry of Tourism, Investments, and Aviation will jointly host the conference that will take place February 10th through 13th, 2025. And the buyer of energy company Equinor's former South Riding Point oil terminal in Grand Bahama, the Wathan Group, has secured a loan guarantee from the Export-Import Bank of the United States for more than $71.3 million. That's going to help the company to relaunch the terminal. According to Wathan, EXIM's loan guarantee represents one of the largest by the bank for a project in the Caribbean Community Country, or CARICOM, a spokesperson saying that the loan bolsters the company's commitment to operational excellence and strategic asset growth. And Aggreko, which has provided supplemental power generation to BPL for several years, is expanding its Bahamas operations through the opening of an office. While the statement does not explain how far the company's services will extend, or if it will become another independent generator for BPL, Guardian Business understands the company is set to make another big announcement next week. Local director for Aggreko Bahamas, Jeffrey Beckles, says in that statement released yesterday that the company is well positioned to support the growth and improvement of the country's power supply. In your Market Watch, recapping trading of the BISX from Monday, your market movers: AML Foods Limited moving 2,000 shares, closing at 420, up 10 cents. Cable Bahamas moving 900, closing at 420, unchanged. Closing at $10, unchanged. Consolidated Water down 14 cents to $6. And Emir Incorporated down 6 cents to $8.35. The BISX All Share Index closing at 2,780.43, up 0.48. That's your Market Watch. And that is your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations. And attend the CFAL Pension and Economic Conference Thursday at Bahama Convention Center. Morning Glenn will be broadcasting live from there on Thursday. And Laverne, that's going to do it for us today. Thank you always, as always, for being with us.
Always a pleasure.
And I'll see you next week, Thursday, when we get back on our regular schedule. But thanks again. And that is going to do it.